first speaker is the former Vice President and General Manager of Transportation Solutions Division of Intel, and an expert in autonomous driving. Please welcome to the stage, Elliot Garbus.
Trains itself, hence deep learning. And then, of course, big data, right? The fact that we've got data centers filled with computers by companies like Google and Amazon, and there are many others. And these two capabilities together are, in many ways, enabling capabilities for autonomous vehicles. I've done work with the guys at Google now, Waymo, on their vehicle, and they have been at it longer than anyone. And they shared that deep learning let them get rid of all sorts of error-prone software that had been in their vehicles. So these are a set of enabling technologies, but having technology is not sufficient to drive a disruption. You need some business motivations. The economic motivations are staggering. So the annual savings to the U.S. economy has been estimated to be $1.3 trillion. Globally, it's expected to be over $5 trillion. It is enormous numbers. The productivity gains, over $500 billion of productivity gains annually. Right. So those are really quite incredible, and I'll show you some more data on the transformative pricing that's enabled by this technology. For me personally, and particularly when this was part of what my day job was, the thing that really moved me was the opportunity to save lives. So today, globally, 1.3 million people a year are killed in traffic accidents, one way or the other. A good percentage of them are not in cars, right? They're bicyclists, they're pedestrians, right? There are another 50 million that are injured every year. And these are shocking numbers. And so the opportunity to apply technology and save this number of lives is really quite remarkable, and I think very exciting. Now, 1.3 million people, that's one of those big, stupid numbers it's hard to get your hands around. So let's take a smaller number. So in the U.S., the number is about 40,000 people a year. As the economy has been going up, that number has been going up, unfortunately. So 40,000 people, that's about 20% of the population of Little Rock, right? It's a shocking big number. But looking at it in a different way, that is the same as a 737 falling out of the sky every weekday. Right. I flew here. You guys probably drove. I'm probably safer. So, you know, it's shocking. Now, these numbers in the United States they're horrifying. There's no other way to look at it. Now, in China, the number is 230,000 people. 60% of those killed are not in a car. Right? That's a major problem for the Chinese. Now, why would I mention China? China is now the world's largest market for automobiles. GM sells more cars in China than they do in the US. Right? So this is a place where a lot is happening and where a lot of automotive trends can be set by regulation. Chinese recently said they're going to set a do not sell by date for combustion engines, that they're going to shift to outlawing the sale of combustion engines so that China will be all electric. Why are they doing that? Pollution in Beijing and Shanghai has been horrific lately, particularly during the summer months. And so they're focused on how do they clean that up. And moving to electric vehicles is part of it. So what's the outcome of that? Well, Ford recently announced they've increased their investment in electric vehicles by $5 billion. GM has rolled out a much broader line of electric cars. Daimler, Mercedes-Benz, has rolled out a line of electric cars, all largely in response to a statement coming out of the China. Now, there are a number of other Western countries that also have made similar moves towards electric vehicles. But it's the power that the Chinese have that's important, and I'll come back to that in just a few minutes. So, see, it was the Monday before Christmas. I was supposed to have a vacation day, and the CEO of Intel asked me to come in to review a strategy on autonomous driving. And in December of 2015, the industry had a very clear view of autonomous driving. There were a set of non-traditional players, Google, Uber, Baidu in China, that were all investing heavily in fully autonomous vehicles. But they were all treating them like science projects. You couldn't talk about business model, you couldn't talk about schedules, they were in research groups, they wouldn't talk. The traditional automakers all had a long, slow view. They would add safety features slowly, and that by 2030, they'd get to autonomous vehicles. So I reviewed that as part of the kind of strategy with the Intel CEO, and as a semiconductor company selling chips to auto companies, we were very concerned that this market wouldn't grow fast enough for us. Isn't there something we can do to get traditional automotive guys interested? Well, December happened, lovely holiday. First week in January, everyone goes to the Consumer Electronics Show. We met with a big German automaker, and they said, it's BMW. We had one of these beautiful executive presentations. I don't know if you guys do this in banking. So, lead from BMW, the head of Intel, the underlings have all gotten together. There's not a bad word in the slide deck. It's perfect about all the great things we're doing together. The head of BMW says, I can see our two teams are really working well together. I don't want to waste any more time on that. What I want to tell you is I don't want to be a subcontractor to Google, and I'm looking for a technology partner. Would you be my technology? And so by July of the following year, that was now public information. And in the meantime, everyone announced. And the race really kicked off. And part of what kicked that off was simply fear. And there was a ton of fear in the industry. I met with another very well-known automotive company, the head of engineering. for the entire group. At the time, they were the largest automaker, both by volume and revenue. And he said, we're afraid of becoming Kodak, that the business model and the technology would just become obsolete. Another observation from an automotive executive, Google could buy any auto company they want. There's not an auto company that could consider buying. Fear was rampant. Not only was fear rampant, there was also opportunity in the air. The CEO of Uber started approaching auto companies offering to buy lots of cars. So he went to Mercedes-Benz and offered to buy 100,000 S-Class vehicles as soon as they're fully autonomous. Right. Those are like $120,000 starting price. Buy 100,000 of them. Wow, that's a board conversation. Did the same thing to Nissan-Renault Alliance, but the offer was to buy 250,000 vehicles. Right. Those cars aren't quite as expensive. Right. And so between fear and opportunity, this fueled a whole race and a lot of people jumping in. Ford was among them. And in September of 2016, Ford had an investor day, and they presented these next two slides to their investors, and I think they're rather remarkable. Let me unpack some of the language here. So AV is autonomous vehicle technology, will lower TaaS. TaaS is transportation as a service. Transportation as a service is like Uber, right? You don't own the car, it's just a service. It's effectively a taxi ride. So it'll lower TaaS prices, increase access and usage. And so what they called out is a taxi is about $6 a passenger mile. Uber or a ride-hailing trip is about $2.50 a passenger mile. You drive yourself, it's about $1.50 a passenger mile. You drive an autonomous vehicle, or better yet, you're driven by an autonomous vehicle, it's about $1 a passenger mile. And mass transit is 30 cents a passenger mile. Right? A rather remarkable change in the cost of a trip. Right? Really very powerful. Now, how is this going to roll out? There are a number of different levels of autonomy. People talk about level, or the Society of Automotive Engineers defines five levels from level one to level five. The focus is on what's called level four, which is driverless vehicles in a geofenced area. So these geofenced areas are major metropolitan areas. Here Ford is showing New York City, plus Newark Airport in New Jersey, or their hometown, and Metro Detroit, and two of the major suburbs. Right? So that those would be the areas that have autonomous vehicles. Waymo, part of what was Google, now part of Alphabet, has announced that this year they're going to launch a fully autonomous driving service in the Phoenix area, where I live, covering 100 square miles. And those areas will just expand. Waymo has been testing in 25 cities across the United States. It's my expectation that they'll start a land grab as soon as they've got enough success and have got the model working. Now, I talked a little bit about China. I want to go back to that. In China, there's a couple of dynamics that are just fascinating. First, the Chinese government has declared only Chinese companies can operate autonomous vehicles in China. That could be just simply protectionism. They've also declared it's a national security concern that autonomous vehicles can be used as weapons. Autonomous vehicles, as you'll see in a minute, rely on high-definition maps. Only two companies in China are licensed to do high-definition maps. One of them is Baidu. If you're not familiar with Baidu, Baidu is effectively the Google of China. Google doesn't really operate in China. They've left China. Baidu is the big search engine, the big advertising platform, but they're much more deeply integrated in that they've got lots of other properties. So things like OpenTable is a Baidu property in China. So a very powerful company. In China, the provincial governor are incredibly powerful. And they are pulling on Baidu to launch their vehicles in their provinces and in their cities because they've got these problems of pollution, of congestion, of fatality. And so they've made statements to Baidu leadership, like, hey, we won't let any other cars drive in the city. Right? It's really rather remarkable. All right, so I'm going to turn you all into self-driving automotive engineers. It's only four slides. I'm going to do it quickly, just so you get a little sense of what the technology is and that it is real. So first, I talked about high-definition maps. So a high-definition map maps the position of your vehicle to a centimeter, right? So this is not GPS, where the GPS doesn't know if you're on the exit ramp or on the freeway. This is to a centimeter. Now, if you think about it, if you can know where your car is to a centimeter, effectively now, a vehicle is like a train riding on virtual track. Right? It's trivial to move it around and control it. So that's the first step. And everyone who's doing this work today is using this approach. And they're building high-definition maps. And you can see that that high-definition map model actually works very well if you're going to be focused on a geofenced area. Right, on that, the city. And for a company like Uber or a service like Uber or Lyft, You've got humans in your network that are drivers. You'll ultimately have autonomous vehicles that are drivers. And when I call for a ride, I let you know where I am and where I'm going. And if that's in the zone, that's kind of the city center, that's autonomous. An autonomous vehicle can pick me up. If not, they can send a human driver. And ultimately, they'll extend that geofence, and it'll be all autonomous vehicles. Next step, okay, so now I can control the vehicle like a virtual train on a track. Now I need to worry about all of those things around me. The pedestrians, the bicyclists, pets, garbage, anything that I can't put easily on a map. And so to do that, vehicles have a set of sensors on them. So they'll have LIDAR. LIDAR sends a laser out and creates a 3D map of the world around you. You'll have regular cameras, you'll have radar. And these sensors get fused together to create a 360-degree view of the world around the vehicle. Next step is to kind of use all of that information to populate an environmental model. You can think of this environmental model almost as the reverse of a 3D game. Okay, I've seen a pedestrian. They started walking through the walkway. My expectation is that over the next tenth of a second, they're going to take half a step forward. That bike is going to move forward, that the cars, other cars are going to move forward. And every tenth of a second, I'm going to update that model, predicting where things are going to go. And then take all of that information and use it to plan where I'm going to go. Have it drive my decision making so that I can basically drive. And this photo is actually from the Google vehicle. And so these big pink boxes that you see are other vehicles. The green is the path it's going to take. There are a set of fences where there are things to be concerned about. Little white vertical box is a bicycle. Effectively, there's a fence there. Right? You've got to make sure you can safely pass that bicycle. So it's coming. Now, as I described this technology as disruptive, so what we saw is the cost of a taxi, the cost of a ride, is going to drop substantially. But it's going to go to a dollar, right? It'll actually go below that as the technology matures. It's estimated that the average American family will save $5,000 a year by no longer having to own a car. Right? Rather remarkable, right? I don't have insurance, I'm car payments, I'm not paying for gas, I'm just paying for a trip. Now, part of the other thing that is really remarkable when that happens, and as the price comes down so dramatically, is who's going to pay for the ride? Right? It opens up an opportunity that someone else could decide it's in their best interest to pay for me to go somewhere. So you can imagine a restaurant. I make a restaurant reservation, and they decide to throw in a free taxi ride. And if I'm willing to buy another cocktail or two, they probably made money on the deal. The fact that the small percentage of people decided to go for another cocktail or two, it's probably worked out for them. Hell, if they own the building or have a parking lot, they may be able to put a patio out there, open up a few more tables, rather than giving that up to parking space. If you're a big employer and you've got tons of real estate tied up in parking lots, you may be making a decision, do I pay to provide a service to bring my employees to work and turn my parking lots into a space for a new building? Or do I leave that all that parking space there and start looking for more real estate to buy? There's some very interesting trade-offs. Now, some of the this sounds like a little out there. I'm going to go back to China. Today, Baidu sells 50% of all of the movie tickets in China. Not 50% of the online movie tickets, 50% of all movie tickets. Baidu is kind of the open table of China. And there's a whole lot of other services that they integrate. So their ability to integrate a whole bunch of services and stitch them together with transportation, I think will end up serving as a role model, if nothing else, for a lot of companies in the West and here in the US. And that really sets up a whole bunch of very interesting changes when you're not paying for your own ride. So the disruptors, the Waymos, the Google, Baidu, Uber, are in a much stronger position because as the business model changes, they're in a much better position to stitch together ecosystems than the traditional automakers are. Now, the traditional automakers, these are proud, 100-year-old companies that are deeply siloed and have trouble getting out of their own way. Brilliant people. But in the face of these kinds of changes, it's going to be hard for them to adapt. Today, we use our vehicles about 4% of the time. Some people have said we buy our cars for the right to park them because they spend most of their time parked. Right? That drives a tremendous lot of volume through factories. If vehicle utilization goes up dramatically, as it will in a transportation as a service model, the number of vehicles will decline dramatically. And that is going to be a real problem for manufacturing companies. It's just part of the reality. And unfortunately, that's coming. And that sets up this remarkable tension between the metal vendors and the disruptors, the metal vendors being the traditional automakers. Now, many of these car makers, these proud companies with 100-year histories, are working desperately to get in the game because they don't have a choice. What else are they going to do? Roll over and die? So Ford has got a program that they launched to build autonomous vehicles. They've rolled $1 billion into a small startup outside of Carnegie Mellon, which is being led by Brian Selesky, who was one of the original developers on the Google program, who's created a startup. BMW's partnered with Intel and Mobileye with the notion of creating an open platform that other OEMs can use. Volvo has had their own program and is providing vehicles to Uber. Chrysler has really very little in the way of technical capability, but those Waymo vehicles are Chrysler minivans. And just, I think it was last week, Waymo announced they're buying 20,000 Jaguar I-Pace electric SUVs. For the Phoenix area, right? So a lot of car purchases going on now from Waymo. So that is all coming. So let's put some numbers around some of these changes I spoke about. First, by 2030, the UN estimates that 66% of the world's population will live in megacities. Megacities are cities with populations of 10 million or more people. And Mexico City's got roughly 25 million people. I think Shanghai's got 27. Beijing is 18 million. And there are plenty of these enormous cities. I think 70% of them are across Asia. There are quite a few in Latin America. Those cities, again, pollution, traffic, parking, these are devastating problems. 30% of the real estate in a city is typically given up to parking. 30%. So again, rather remarkable opportunities if you don't have to park. And it opens up changes. Now, as bankers, I imagine you've got some percentage of your portfolio in real estate that's important to you. This is coming. I don't know what to do about it, but it's coming. It was an author very interestingly said, hey, if I don't have cars anymore, what do I do with my garage? Right? Do I fix it up and open up an Airbnb using my garage? There's plenty of used storage around, you know, these little storage facilities, right? Are they under pressure if suddenly I don't have a car in my garage? I've opened up a whole lot of real estate to store my own junk. There's a group called RethinkX that published a paper recently, and they are among the most aggressive proponents of autonomous driving. They estimated that by 2030, 95% of U.S. passenger miles will be in autonomous taxis. 95%. Right? It's really kind of stunning. This is the one that I think is most frightening, in particular for automakers and really the entire automotive supply chain. Right? And it's an estimate that by 2030, the number of vehicles on the road in the US is going to drop by about 200 million vehicles. Right? So today, light cars and trucks, or it's estimated by 2020, it's a straight line, about 247 million vehicles in the U.S. And that number is going to drop to 44 million by 2030. Right? That's a stunning reduction. Stunning. The number of workers who are employed as drivers, and this is a number from 2014, and it doesn't include Uber drivers. It excludes kind of Uber and Lyft drivers. It's over 2 million, right? And those jobs are going to disappear. And I talked a lot about the testing going on, in particular with passenger vehicles. And in Arizona, it's hard to drive in the Phoenix area without bumping into autonomous vehicles. Waymo is testing. Uber is testing. Unfortunately, we saw the first fatality in an Uber vehicle in Tempe, Arizona, just recently. GM is testing. Ford is testing. So there's a lot of autonomous vehicles on the road there. Not only are there autonomous passenger vehicles being tested, though, there's also long-haul trucks being tested. Right? And riding on a freeway is almost trivial compared to riding in a city. Right? If you go back to that technology model that I shared, you know, so much of it is what's around me. What are the things I can't put on a map? There's not that much around you on the freeway. Right? It's pretty much a straight shot with a high-definition map and all of the sensors. Everything that you're doing for the city, freeway driving is kind of like a subset. I should share maybe just an amusing story, amusing to me anyway. One of the leading technology suppliers to auto companies, I'm not going to mention the name because I don't want to embarrass anybody, their CTO ended up through a corporate reorg, ending up with the autonomous driving group. Like me, a guy in his mid-50s, he tells me on the telephone, Elliot, I don't think this autonomous thing is going to happen. I love my car. I don't think anyone's ever going to go for this. I think it's going to happen. Glenn was the other guy's name. We were going to meet in Detroit the following week. I said, you go meet with your team. He's going to meet with his team in Mountain View for the first time. You go meet with your team, and then let's get back together in Detroit, and you tell me what you think. We get back together, and he is super excited. Elliot, it's going to happen. I'm convinced. So, well, Glenn, what happened to change your mind? sitting in the back of the car, looking at the laptop that shows what the car sees around it. And as they're driving along, the Home Depot truck is unloading doors. And a few doors flop onto the road. And he said, the car drew a red box around it and just changed lanes and smoothly drove around it. I'm convinced it's going to happen. And it is going to happen. But it's not going to end just with cars, because there's a lot more going on there. And this is really, I think, crazy. There's an incredible amount of investment going into air taxis, and in particular, electric vertical takeoff and landing vehicles. I do some consulting now. I was talking with a venture capital firm I'm working with, and they've got a lot of investments in these sorts of companies. There's a company in particular called Joby Aviation that Intel just made a $100 million investment into. And they're all working on very similar technologies. So there are currently 40 separate electrical vertical takeoff and landing aircraft under development. They're electric. They've got a lot of small propellers. They take off like a helicopter. Propellers tip forward, flies like an airplane. It's talking about $1 a passenger mile for a vehicle. Some of these companies are talking about 80 cents a passenger mile. They hold 4 to 6 people, and it's crazy. It's absolutely crazy. I was at CES this year. I think it was, I'm embarrassed, I can't remember. It might have been the Bell helicopter. It was at CES. Like, what the hell is a helicopter company doing at CES? And it largely seemed to be a recruiting activity. That they are moving this way, and it was all about how do you hire people. This VC I've been talking with has shared with me a lot of construction companies they work with are now making sure their rooftops can support pads for this class of vehicle. Now, if you think about it, traffic in cities like LA and New York are very attractive to get where you're going in 20 minutes rather than spending an hour in traffic. If I go back to those kind of mega cities, Seoul in particular, Seoul's about 25 million people, Samsung executives routinely take helicopters between buildings. This would be much more pleasant, more cost-effective, and ultimately safer. And they're coming. All right. I'm going to leave you with this image of 1957's view of the future, the electric autonomous vehicle. I think I've got a few minutes. If we want to do maybe some questions, if anyone has any questions, I'd be happy to take. So the question was, didn't see Tesla on the presentation. So I talk about different levels of autonomy. So Tesla has been very focused on level 3 right now. So level 3 is there's a human in the loop. And there are a lot of companies that are actually making these kinds of investments. It very much fits into what a traditional auto company is doing. So we'll see this year, next year, a number of companies coming out with what I call scenario-based automation. So I get on the freeway, much like autopilot from Tesla. I push a button. The vehicle drives, can change lanes, but I have to be ready to take over and to get off the lane I need to go off. And Tesla's been in the news. They hired a very brilliant guy. I've met with him a few times, Jim Keller. And I've read that he's starting up a team that are looking at designing some products specifically for full autonomy. But they haven't done, they're really nowhere. They haven't really been testing vehicles. They haven't been chasing a driverless model. And so this, while I talk about autonomous, I really mean driverless, because that's what changes the world.
What's the point of the Ford maps of New York and Detroit area? Are they going to have exclusive rights to do autonomous vehicles in those areas, or why do they have it?
Yeah, so Ford was really just demonstrating how they would roll out kind of transportation as a service, that it would start in a geofenced area that they would use, kind of the city center, and expand it over time, link suburbs, connect to airports. So it's really just kind of a model. But that is the model that all of these companies are pursuing. I should share, Uber drivers today cover 95% of New York City streets every 7 minutes. Right? So as these vehicles become autonomous, they're also going to be continually mapping the area they cover and keeping those maps updated. I've talked at the very beginning about how the cloud and artificial intelligence play a role. So the vehicle will start to play two roles. One, it's kind of a knowledge playback engine. It's learned how to drive, so it's going to do that driving. But it's also collecting data. So if there's construction, that'll be shared. If there's something that's disrupting traffic, that'll be shared, and that'll go into the route. So how far did Tempe set back Uber? So it's impossible to say at this point. You know, I think it's a huge PR blow for them. I think more importantly, it hasn't set back Waymo, it hasn't set back Google. That John Krafcik has said, you know, well, it was a horrible, John Krafcik is the CEO of Waymo. Well, you know, that was horrible, it would never have happened in a Waymo vehicle. Big focus on safety, and they're full steam ahead. They announced that deal with Jaguar just recently. I think one of the things that's important to understand is Google had a huge head start. They've been invested maybe since 2009 in autonomous vehicles. It had started as what was called the Google X project. And it was strictly a research program. And now they've brought in more folks over the past couple of years with kind of business backgrounds and have turned it into a business model. The guys at Alphabet, right, the Google parent company, as they look for growth and they see Uber's valuation, that's a great bet. Right? They're all in on it. We'll have to see what happens with the outcome of the investigation. But clear something was wrong. An autonomous vehicle should not be hitting somebody like that. If you haven't seen the video, if you've got a strong stomach, it's worth watching. It is really horrifying that that woman was hit.
Any concerns that the,
what do
you say, don't you?
So the question, if you didn't hear it, any concern about the cost of repair, software, technology, kind of blowing the value equation that I described to you? That's a very interesting question. Remember, you've got a rather big ownership change. Right, so you've got a vehicle that effectively is going to be in service close to 24/7 versus 4%. So effectively, it's shared ownership in a way, right? Effectively. So it's not going to be a problem. Now, what a number of these transportation as a service companies have told me independently, having discussions about costs and vehicle life, If the vehicle only lasts 2 years and it costs up to $300,000, they can make the model work. Right. Now let's talk a little bit about costs. Right. So while there's a tremendous amount of compute power in these vehicles, typically those computers are a server class system, and they consume 1 to 3 kilowatts of power. It's a lot of power for a computer. Right. Big computer, the cost is predominantly in sensors, and in particular, it's one class of sensor. It's LiDAR. Those LiDAR sensors used to be like a spinning tin can on the top of a Toyota Prius on those initial Google test vehicles. That spinning tin can cost $73,000. Before the automakers were so frightened about all this technology, they used to joke that that is a car mounted underneath a sensor. Right? The sensor costs twice more, probably close to three times more. The cost of that sensor has come down dramatically. So Velodyne is the manufacturer of that $73,000 sensor. They now sell the equivalent capability for about $7,000. There are at least 60 startups doing and mature companies doing work to create much lower cost LiDAR. We'll see another order of magnitude drop over the next year. I'm working with a company that believes that you get below $200. Right. So it's coming. I've spoken with other startups that had plans to get below $150. And so the costs are all coming down, and if they can afford $300,000, it's not going to be an issue.
What's the effect on public investments in highways and transit systems? For instance, Nashville, Tennessee is considering spending $10 billion on a light rail system that will be financed with long-term bonds, and I'm sure there's other projects like that out there. What does that do to that as a value proposition?
Well, I personally, I think it dramatically erodes that value. This is not a hard data point, but it's just anecdotal. It's probably worth following up. In Los Angeles, when Uber came into town, just Uber today, not autonomous, $2.25 a mile versus 30 cents a mile for mass transit. When Uber came to LA, the utilization of LA's transit system dropped. Right? While it costs a whole lot more, it is much more convenient. And if you can afford it, you're going to use it. And it's not that much more. Right? So I think as that price drops by half, it really puts those kinds of big public spending programs at risk. But it's a gamble, right? I'm clearly a technologist who sees this coming, and I view it as an unstoppable force. Others have different opinions. They're wrong, but it's clear. What about trucking? So, as I mentioned, right, long-haul trucking is also being tested. Uber has a long-haul trucking service. Waymo has a long-haul trucking service. I just read a couple of days ago that Honda, this hasn't been officially announced, but that Honda is collaborating with Waymo to create some sort of custom delivery vehicle. Talking about it not having even steering wheel and pedals, right? So these areas are coming. I think there are going to be other opportunities. No one talks about garbage trucks, for example. But I think clearly garbage trucks are great, you know, opportunity. Garbage trucks are great, oh yeah, and you follow me. And there are a number of companies that have sprung up that will enable these sorts of technologies to go into some different spaces. So Delphi split the company in two and created a new company called Aptiv. Aptiv is really all of their advanced safety and electronics technologies. They are partnering with BMW. They've done a couple of acquisitions that were really very interesting. They acquired a company that had come out of Carnegie Mellon called Automatica that they got before all of this fever around autonomous vehicles started. And then they acquired a company more recently called Mutonomy. Mutonomy came out of MIT and had been running autonomous taxis in Singapore. Government of Singapore has been providing a lot of incentives for investment around autonomous vehicles. So Aptiv acquired them. Aptiv was also doing testing in Singapore. So they're a supplier. Quite likely they would be supplying technologies to others. Chris Olmsted, who had been the CTO of Google's self-driving car project, left Google. He's created a company called Aurora. You can imagine with his pedigree, he's had no trouble raising money. He's got a ton of investment and will be delivering these sorts of technologies to many others. Industrial companies, Caterpillar, has a vision of a fully autonomous mine. They call it from pit to port. No people involved from the mining pit all the way to the port. Right, and are busy investing in those kinds of technologies. John Deere has a number of autonomous tractors for farming. Right, those farming projects in many ways are easy. You know, while it may be sad to take out a ground squirrel, farmer probably would have done it anyway. You don't have to worry about too many pedestrians and bicyclists running through a cornfield.
What's the transition
from gas taxes? So the question is, so how do you transition from gas taxes to support highways to some new model? I think there are a lot of opportunities. You know, effectively, gas tax you can think of as a use tax, right? And it's tied directly to effectively how much I drive, right? These kinds of vehicles, it's very clear how much they're driving. And so you could have a use tax that goes against an Uber or a Waymo or something like that. That's a per mile or per ride tax. But that'll be one of the great things we get to figure. How I'm doing on time? Do a couple more questions? Maybe not.
You mentioned that people are wrong when they say this isn't going forward. But what's the argument that you hear most and how do you counteract
that? So the question was, okay, Elliot, you're clearly insane and think this science fiction view of the world is going to happen. What are the arguments for rational people that say this is not going to happen? So there's a few things. One, people talk about regulation, right? Now, I don't buy the whole regulation argument. Regulation can be a barrier, but I think what we see generally globally is more of a pull for this technology than holding it back. To me, the thing that's most likely to hold it back is something horrific happened. You know, in some ways we saw it with the Uber accident, right? If we were to have some horrific accident, an autonomous vehicle hits a busload of kittens, you know, that could really set things back. And I think those sorts of things. But in particular, when we've got the Chinese government pushing for it so much. We've got all of these trends heading towards megacities and the problems that they've got, and the opportunity for a technology solution to address so many of those problems in a way that's so much more cost effective and going to be driven by private investment over having to build a Nashville light rail system. For cities like, again, Bangkok and Shanghai, even smaller cities of 10 million people like Nanjing and China, right, this is a very attractive solution. And so my expectation is it's unstoppable. So those are the arguments, though. something horrific could happen, and regulation. Like both of those things aren't going to happen. The reason so much testing is happening right now in Arizona is because the governor has been very bullish on it. State of California was giving Uber a hard time testing vehicles, saying, hey, you guys need to have special licenses to test autonomous vehicles. But we said, hey, the vehicle's not autonomous yet. We have people driving. California said, hey, that's an autonomous vehicle. You need to pay this for this license. Governor Arizona called up Uber and said, we'd love to have you. It's the Wild West out here. Come on board. And so we got it.
We talk about concepts and disruptive concepts, but even here today, your mic cuts in and out. High-tech mic cuts in and out. The cloud is slower than Christmas. I mean, and so you've gone to these NVIDIA computers and cars to drive all the technology, and yet, as your presentation, the technology, your mic cuts out. I mean, the risk, I mean.
It's not my mic, it's your mic.
It's the center's mic, you know. But it didn't disrupt your talk, though.
Yeah.
But those kind of things I wonder about is how far has technology got to go to be consistent to protect us?
It's a great question. So again, for those of you that didn't hear, the question is, Elliot, you can't even operate a microphone. How the hell are we going to trust you with an autonomous call? So there's an interesting set of industry standards, a very catchy name, might want to write it down, ISO 26262. And this specification defines what's called functional safety. And functional safety means that the system needs to fail operational. Not fail safe, fail operational. You're right, you can't have an automobile kind of blue screen. Oh, just reboot the vehicle. We've all had to power off our phones occasionally. We've had to reboot computers. That's unacceptable for an automobile, especially if you're going to say, I don't know, 200 kilometers an hour on the Autobahn. Right. That would be problematic. So the way these systems go together is typically there's a relatively simple, highly reliable computer. That simple, highly reliable computer is rated at automotive safety integrity level D. It's typically redundant. Two copies of everything, and they're always checking. You've got two much bigger computer systems that are actually doing the driving. And as long as they agree, the checker does what they say. And if they don't agree, then it goes into some kind of operational safe mode. Okay, we need to pull over and park. And so that those technologies do exist and are being applied. There's an awful lot of these sorts of technologies that exist today in trains and other industrial safety standards. Are they perfect? They're not perfect. But today, we also need to remember we've got 1.3 million people dying a year on the world's roads. And that 94% of them are due to human error. 94% of those collisions or accidents or due to human error. And I don't know if you've got this problem in Arkansas, but I can tell you it is horrifying to drive in Phoenix and look over at an erratic driver and see them texting while they're driving. And you are 27 times more likely to be in an accident if you're texting and driving. 27 times. Right? It's really horrific. While I don't advocate drinking and driving, you're safer. So don't drink and text it.
So we've actually had this conversation in my work about, you know, people that would be early adopters to autonomous driving versus late adopters. And while I think I would be somebody who's willing to do it, I've talked to a number of coworkers who say things like, I don't trust a computer to drive me, I don't want to give up a truck.
Yeah.
And things of this nature. How do you get people
So first you brought up a very interesting element, which is trust, right? And we need to have technologies that help to build, I'm sorry, I should repeat the question. The question was, how do you get everyone in these things? What happens to the guy that loves his truck and won't give it up? Some people are concerned about the technology. So how do you address that? I told the story of my friend Glenn, who saw a screen that showed what the car saw and made him feel confident. So first, within the vehicle itself, we need to create trust between the vehicle and the passenger. There's actually been quite a bit of user-driven research about how you do that. It comes down to two core elements. First, does the car see what I see? I see a woman pushing a stroller across the street. Does the vehicle see that? Good, that makes me feel better. And then second, I said I want to go to the Bill and Hillary Clinton International Airport at 3 o'clock. Is that where the car is taking me? And if I see those things and I start to experience them, people will get more comfortable. I've had the pleasure, it's really been a pleasure, of driving in a lot of fully autonomous vehicles. And for me, the experience is universally the same. I start as a technologist being more excited than you can imagine, like a kid in a candy store, watching all of this technology work. And then it very quickly moves to boredom as I'm sitting in what is really a very boring drive that carefully obeys the speed limits, slows before intersections. I mean, it's just a bore. Delphi was at CES a couple of years ago, and a wired reporter took a drive vehicles. Is that microphone? And the reporter said, operated by a robot, drives like a nun. Right, and that really kind of captured the experience. So I think, first, as those technologies come into place, people will learn to trust these vehicles, and then the costs are going to be compelling. There's also a set of a good percentage of the population that is getting older now that can't safely drive by themselves, that are really looking forward to to retain mobility. My father is 92 years old, and God bless him. He still drives, but he will only drive within a 6-mile radius around his home and not at night. Right? He would love to have, you know, an autonomous vehicle he can call on that would show up. So,
thank you, sir.
Okay. Looks like that's the big hook. Thank you very much for your attention.